In this lesson, we'll discuss how to solve a set of linear algebraic equations using the Gaussian elimination method with partial pivoting. Here we have a system of four equations, expressed in matrix form as AX equals B. The A matrix contains 16 known coefficients, the B column vector contains 4 known constants, and the X column vector contains 4 unknowns that we wish to determine. We will use I as the row index and J as the column index. The Gaussian elimination method involves two main steps. In the first step, called the forward elimination step, the A matrix is converted into an upper triangular matrix U, in which all the elements below the main diagonal are zero. The B vector is altered during this step, and the name of the resulting vector is C. The X vector is unchanged during this step. Shortly, we will examine how to convert AX equals B into UX equals C, but for now, let's separate the matrix equation into individual linear algebraic equations in order to understand why the UX equals C form allows us to easily solve for the unknowns. Using matrix multiplication, the first equation is U11x1 plus U12x2 plus U13x3 plus U14x4 equals C1. The second equation is U22x2 plus U23x3 plus U24x4 equals C2. The third equation is U33x3 plus U34x4 equals C3. And the last equation is U44x4 equals C4. At this point, recall that the components of the U matrix and B vector are known constants, and we are solving for the unknowns x1, x2, x3, and x4. The second step of the Gaussian elimination method is called the backward substitution step. In this step, we solve all the linear algebraic equations starting from the final equation and ending with the first equation. Solving the last equation for x4, we have x4 equals c4 divided by u44. Now x4 is known. Solving the third equation for x3, we have x3 equals quantity c3 minus u34 x4 divided by u33. Since x4 is known, we can obtain x3. Solving the second equation for x2, we have x2 equals quantity c2 minus u24 x4 minus u23 x3 divided by u22. Since x3 and x4 are known, we can obtain x2. Solving the first equation for x1, we have x1 equals quantity c1 minus u14 x4 minus u13 x3 minus u12 x2 divided by u11. Since x2, x3, and x4 are known, we can obtain x1. These four equations allow us to perform the backward substitution step for a system of four linear algebraic equations, but we would like to develop equations that are valid for a system of any size. So let's take a closer look at the first three equations, where we solve for x1, x2, and x3. We can generate all three equations by using the following formula. Xi equals the quantity ci minus summation uij xj, where j varies from I plus 1 to 4, and this entire quantity is divided by uii. This equation is valid for I equals 1, 2, or 3. When I equals 4, the formula we will use is x4 equals c4 divided by u44. In general, we will have a system of n linear equations and n unknowns. In this particular case, n equals 4. So we can replace the number 4 with n in these equations. When I equals 1 to n minus 1, we will use the equation xi equals the quantity ci minus summation uij times xj, where j varies from I plus 1 to n, divided by uii. When I equals n, we'll use the equation xn equals cn divided by unn. These equations are valid for a system of any size. Now that we have discussed how to perform the backward substitution step, let's return to the subject of how to convert AX equals B into UX equals C in the forward elimination step. We will do this using an example involving a system of four equations. Currently, these equations are in AX equals B form. The A matrix is 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 4, 12, 1, 1, 1, 1, and 1, 2, 4, 8. The B vector is negative 0.2, 0.8, 1.5, and 1.2. It is easier to solve this problem using the augmented matrix, which is simply the B column vector attached to the right side of the A matrix, making a 4x5 matrix. We will use I for the row index and j for the column index. In the forward elimination step, we move along the diagonal elements of the A matrix and perform the same set of tasks at each diagonal element. The first task involves partial pivoting. We start with diagonal element 1, 1, which has the value 0, and is circled in red. Since we are starting with the first diagonal element, we label our current location as k equals 1. Now we prepare to partial pivot. In the current column k, we search through all the rows greater than the value of k to find the element with the highest magnitude. In other words, in column 1, we search through rows 2 through 4, which are highlighted in blue, and check if there is a higher magnitude value than 0. If the value in the diagonal element has a greater magnitude than any of the values below it, no pivoting is necessary. However, if there is a higher magnitude value below the diagonal, then you will swap the current row with the row that has the highest magnitude value. In this case, both rows 3 and 4 have the highest magnitude value in the column, which is 1. It does not matter if you swap row 1 with row 3 or with row 4, but for consistency, we will swap the current row with the row that has the first occurrence of the highest magnitude value. So we swap row 1 and row 3 in the augmented matrix. We will only perform pivoting with rows, which is why we use the term partial pivoting. There's no great advantage to performing the pivoting action on the columns as well. There are some important benefits of partial pivoting. First, recall that the equations for the backward substitution step involve division by the diagonal elements uii. Removing the zeros in the diagonal prevents division by zero. The second benefit of partial pivoting is less obvious, but it can be shown that partial pivoting reduces the chance that computer roundoff errors will significantly alter the solution. The second task in the forward elimination step is performing an elimination pass to reduce all elements below the diagonal element to zero. And we do this by manipulating the rows below the current diagonal element, that is, all rows greater than k. From each of these rows will be subtracted the row of the current diagonal element times some factor, and this factor is the ratio of the element in the current row divided by the diagonal element. In our example, the factor that we will use for the second row is a21, which is 0, divided by the diagonal a11, which is 1. So 0 divided by 1 is 0. So the second row will have 0 times row 1 subtracted from it. The factor for the third row is a31, which is 0, divided by the diagonal a11, which is 1. 0 divided by 1 is 0. So the third row also will have 0 times row 1 subtracted from it. The factor for the fourth row is a41, which is 1, divided by the diagonal a11, which is 1. 1 divided by 1 is 1. So the fourth row will have 1 times row 1 subtracted from it. These manipulations allow us to create a new augmented matrix with zeros below the first diagonal element. Now we move to the second diagonal location and k increases to 2. The value of this diagonal element is 1. First we check if partial pivoting is necessary by searching all the values below the diagonal and checking if there is a higher magnitude value. There is no higher value than 1 in row 3 and row 4, so pivoting is not necessary. Next, we perform an elimination pass on all rows greater than 2. The factor for the third row is a32, which is 1, divided by the diagonal a22, which is also 1, so 1 divided by 1 is 1. The third row will have 1 times row 2 subtracted from it. The factor for the fourth row is a42, which is 1, divided by the diagonal a22, which is 1. 1 divided by 1 is 1, so the fourth row also will have 1 times row 2 subtracted from it. We now have a new augmented matrix with zeros below the second diagonal element. We move to the third diagonal location and k increases to 3. The value of this diagonal element is negative 2. We check if partial pivoting is necessary by searching below the diagonal and looking for a higher magnitude value. Negative 2 has a higher magnitude than the value in row 4, which is negative 1, so pivoting is not necessary. Next, we perform an elimination pass on all rows greater than 3. The factor for the fourth row is a43, which is negative 1, divided by the diagonal a33, which is negative 2. Negative 1 divided by negative 2 is 0.5, so we subtract 0.5 times row 3 from row 4. This gives us a new augmented matrix with a 0 below the third diagonal element. Since all the elements below the main diagonal of the original A matrix are now 0, we have completed the forward elimination step and can implement the backward substitution step. Split the augmented matrix into an upper triangular matrix U and the column vector C. The U matrix is 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 4, 12, 0, 0, negative 2, negative 9, 0, 0, 0, negative 0.5. The C vector is 1.5, 0.8, negative 1, and negative 0.6. We now apply the equations for backward substitution. Since there are 4 linear equations in our system, n equals 4. For I equal to 4, we use the equation x4 equals c4 divided by u44. Negative 0.6 divided by negative 0.5 gives 1.2. For x1, x2, and x3, we use the equation quantity ci minus summation uij times xj, where j varies from I plus 1 to 4, divided by uii. We must apply this equation in reverse order, starting with x3. x3 equals quantity c3 minus u34 times x4 divided by u33. After plugging in the values for all quantities, we obtain negative 4.9. Next, we solve for x2, which equals quantity c2 minus u24 x4 minus u23 x3 divided by u22. After plugging in the values, we obtain negative 6. And finally, we solve for x1, which is the quantity c1 minus u14 x4 minus u13 x3 minus u12 x2 divided by u11. And after plugging in all the values, we obtain negative 0.8. In this particular example, we solved the system of equations by hand and found exact solutions. However, computers cannot store numbers with infinite precision, and Roundoff errors can occur. One method of checking the accuracy of the solutions is to plug the x values back into the ax equals b equation and check if the left side of the equations differ greatly from the right side of the equations. We can calculate the difference between the left side and the right side of some equation I using the formula absolute value of the summation from j equals 1 to n of the quantity aij times xj minus bi. We can apply this formula from I equals 1 to I equals n and find the maximum error between the left side and the right side of the linear equations. We compare this maximum error value to some small tolerance value epsilon that we are free to set. If the maximum error is less than epsilon, we have confidence that the solution is accurate enough for our purposes. Let's calculate the error of equation 1. The absolute value of 0x1 plus 1x2 plus 2x3 plus 3x4 minus negative 0.2. After plugging in the values for x1 through x4, we obtain 0. This was expected because we did not use a computer to help us solve this problem. However, if we use MATLAB to solve the system of equations using the backslash operator, then calculated the difference between the left side and right side of the first equation, we would find that the error is 0.17 times 10 to the negative 15 power. This is a very small error, so small you can easily neglect it in almost every engineering application, but it is not zero. Part of the reason why the error is so small is that our system of equations is small. There are only 4 equations. Now, as the system of equations grows in size, the Roundoff error can accumulate and eventually become significant. It can be shown that the number of operations or individual calculations required for the Gaussian elimination method grows roughly as the cube of the number of equations. That is, if we double the number of equations, the number of operations required will increase by a factor of 8. There are other general-purpose algorithms for solving systems of linear algebraic equations, including the Gauss-Seidel method and LU decomposition method, both of which have pros and cons over the Gaussian elimination method. If the A matrix has a special structure, there exist algorithms that take advantage of this structure to solve the system of equations much faster. If the A matrix is tridiagonal, which means all its elements are zero except along the main diagonal and two adjacent diagonals, the TDMA or Thomas algorithm can be employed. The number of operations for this algorithm grows only as the number of equations to the first power, resulting in a very large savings in computational time. If a matrix is symmetric about the diagonal, the Kolesky decomposition algorithm can be implemented, which requires about half the number of operations as the Gaussian elimination method.